sinister? How do you have a heart so sinister? How are you so wasteful when people are dying in Somalia, Afghanistan, Egypt, Libya? The irony is you have no business in Syria. A kid is getting killed for all the business in Syria. And then they try to tell you that it's ISIS. They're killing them. How are these civilians dying? What's the difference between us and them? When you're a drone to the kitchen, how did you end? When a bomb goes off, every politician falls like that long track. You didn't kill 100 men. You ain't the same as them. But all that fuel for the fire is what you gave to them. And what you paid for them. In and out of nursing, struggling, hurting. And I just find it fucked that the government is struggling to care for a person, not care for a person. So where's the destruction? Wages, budgets, how they made with London. When I know it's London, the letters on the cards in my mom's overdraft. But somehow I still have the money in my pocket. And even the little things like order and pizza are probably the reason for all the time in the evening. 5 till 10, 6 hours of sleep. For 22 years, my mom's doing it clean.
Don't help from the house, wouldn't even any of this. the people that survived. His name was a peer. Put that whole name and I can see that he's trying. So with a smile with his eyes and the teeth and the tears. Look, I got a message for my whole prime minister. Dave and Cameron, I mean you fucked up your design and sneaked out the firing line. I wanna know how you managed it. And all you bring within the sun while the pain that I run and a woman that is left here handed in. Because it's easy to be the man that's got a plan and then a woman that is down to abandon it. Are there bullies in school? When you pick them up out of the class, you feel the embarrassment. I mean, that they gave a fuck about you, but that's the truth. There's no sympathy for you or your captain. I really wish I could have seen how you were strangling when you lost the referendum that it had to win. I feel like politicians are all addicts in a big fat game, but it's life to gamble with. I've got a question for the leader of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn, when you want to take the country to. Honestly, I want to put my trust in you, but you can't understand why I've got a trust issue. Do you really have the faith of your party? Do you really have the faith in the party that will come with you? How do you plan on keeping all the promises, man? If I'm being punished, so I'm struggling to deal with it. How do you say, yeah? Everybody's great until you get them into office, and then the guys start forgetting things. Proof was different, don't promise anything. Go and get justice for Sean Charles and Edison. And if you ever can't afford the vote, yeah, before the protest, you don't really see the progress. I hope you know that what they're saying is affecting us. Small steps are way better than no steps.
Thank you. everyone, it's Bevia. Welcome to the makeup tutorial. Today it's party makeup. So first we're going to start off with some moisturiser. It's important to make sure you get the driest bits of your skin, but rub it all in, you don't want to look silly. Foundation is used as a base for the rest of your makeup. Work the foundation from the centre of your face in the airline in gentle upward strokes. A beautician will help guide you to your shade of foundation. Just blend it all together. Make sure there's no smudges on their own. You want it to look as natural as possible, okay? Ah, that's perfect. Now, we're going to put on a little bit of concealer. Dark circles are often caused by not enough sleep and lack of iron. To cover them up, use a concealer 2 to 3 tones lighter to your base. Just dab under your eyes and make sure, if you're tired, this is a very good trick to use. Gives you a little bit of a youthful glow. Now this little beauty, oh, it's fabulous. Take advantage of what's there. Extenuate the good points, minimise the others. Blush can also be used for contouring. For example, a tone 3 shades darker than a foundation can be used to point up a cheekbone or to diminish a strong jawbone. If you can get this brand, I would recommend it, girls. Blush is applied to give cheeks a quiet glow. The best rule to follow is never let blush come near the nose. Oh God. What does he want? I'm not answering it. You busy? Hello, is Beverly here? God, man in it. Okay, guess I'll see you when you're home. Eyebrows frame the eye and keep focus on them. It's also important in the shaping of the nose. To prevent messy brows, you can lubricate them with some baby oil or Vaseline. Just make sure you fill them with as natural as the hair colour as possible. We need to make sure we look after our makeup. Make sure everything's put away in the right place. Oh my gosh, this colour palette, if you haven't got it, get it. A light base will make the eyes look smaller. A dark base will make them appear larger. Eyeshadow should be applied with a finger to make sure no excess powder falls on your face. For contour and enhancers, use a slight darker shade in the lid crease of the eye and blend upwards towards the brow bone. So we're going for a bit more of a duller green, and in a bit we're going to give it a little bit of a bounce with a bright one. Boys will see ya if you wear the brightest colourable possible. Make sure both your eyes are even. Now this is the exciting bit, okay? Make sure your colour makes you smile. When I see myself with this on my eyes, I just can't help but smile because I know how good a looking is. Alright, now it's the eyeliner. Now you've got to be really careful how you do this, okay? Should be used to make the lash line appear longer. There should be no black arch line. Apply as close to the lashes as possible. Fake lashes make your eyelashes appear longer and fuller. Some lashes can make your eyes appear heavy. To prevent this, a good night's sleep is necessary. The right food definitely helps with the sparkle in your eyes. Ooh, here comes the eyelashes. Generally expected age to wear lipstick is around 14. A bold colour is the most upcoming. I have lovely lips. Oh, it rarely does make a difference. Make sure you tell yourself that you have lovely lips, because I'm sure you do. And if you don't, you can just draw them again. This is my favourite colour.
Remember, apply it to every corner of your mouth.
Before applying, tell your lips how beautiful they are. This helps you not miss any corners. Start from the centre of her upper lip, drawing a smooth curve to the outer corner.
It's just a pop!
Now we're all looking beautiful. It's time to get ready for the party. See you all soon.
Well, that's me ready for the party.
Make sure you tune in to my next makeup tutorial. Bye, girls!
Thank you. Lori Cutress is subject to a child protection programme following previous domestic violence instances between both her mother, Sasha Cutress, and her father, Jack Reed. For purposes of the minute taker, we will go round the table, introduce ourselves, and explain what organisation you're from. I will start. I'm Lizzie Heaton. I am Chair of Children Protection Services.
I'm Jack Reed, and I'm Lori's dad.
I'm
Hannah
Wheeler, and I'm Laurie
Talbot. I'm John Rawlinson, I work for Merseyside Police.
I'm Susan Newman, and I'm Laurie's social worker.
I'm Jenny Jones, and Laurie attends my nursery. I'm your childcare provider.
Sasha Cutress, and I'm Laurie's mother.
Okay, thank you for the introductions. We have asked you here today to discuss progression of Laurie Francis's future. The most recent incident reported was a domestic dispute between both parents, in which a knife was being waved around in the presence of Lori. Would mum or dad like to comment on that?
Yeah, I know. That's because she's a fucking bag-edged slut with major mental health problems.
Mental health issue I have with you.
Firstly, we are not here for a slanging match. Maybe we should hear from some of the professionals? Pam, are there any general observations regarding parent health or parent capacity?
Both mum and dad remain separated. Mum has a history of anxiety and depression. She is currently taking Venlafaxine 37.5 milligrams. She was last seen the 14th of August 2018 when her mood was this. I don't think mental health has a significant impact on her parenting capacity. Dad has been treated for anxiety and depression in the past. There have been compliance issues with medication and also engagement with the secondary mental health team. Dad has a history of cannabis misuse.
Mr. Reed also has a history of violent offences, cocaine use, suicide attempts, and has discussed mental illness.
Mr. Reed has not engaged with mental health services. He has no fix for those. Mr. Reed has no contact with his family.
Speaking on behalf of the nursery, we continue to have a good relationship with Sasha. She is very bubbly and chatty. Most of the time, we will contact the nursery if Laurie does not attend. Sasha is always well presented and remains a bubbly personality. Sasha is the main kid who drops and picks Laurie up from school. We feel that Laurie is well cared for by mum. However, we feel if mum and dad are together unsupervised with Laurie present, this may cause significant risk.
Cocaine use, not engaged.
things. Just more and more and more things. September 3rd, September 10th, September 14th, September the 18th, September 21st.
One day I asked the blind man if he knew what the colors were. He said, well, I've never seen them, but in my mind, the color yellow feels like the warm rays of sunshine. The color green, I imagine, is what covers the soft carpet of grass and empty meadow. The color red must be the screech of sirens and horns, and I could have sworn that I felt the calm of blue in the waters of the Atlantic. You see, my friend, I may not have the gift of sight, but I am thankful to be spared the blackness that engulfs the world at night. Although I cannot distinguish dark from light, I can still tell wrong from right. I can hear hidden tones in music that most people cannot. I can dream of beauty from just the scent of a rose. I can feel the crisp droplets of rain on my skin, and unlike others, I can actually see the wind. Never feel bad for a blind man, he said finally. For you see the world for what it is, while I see it for what it could be.
Thank you. I'm not lonely. I've been laying here for 4 days now. She was trying to bring food in, but I'm not to have any. Not to have any food to drink. I've been on a diet since Wednesday now. And nobody's going to stop me! Keep banging and knocking the bastard door. But I won't answer. Because what's up there any road, eh? They also put a sign over the door top of the gents. Because out there's a bog. Out there's a big fat toilet. It's true that. True as breath, that little comment. True as trees. Fuck me. You babble when you haven't eaten in a while, don't you? There's always falling out of your thoughts. You get a great brain full in your mouth, just sicks them out. And that's what I'm seeking on, to get everything out. Right the way out. And that's why I'm on the diet. Fucking hell. My throat's a bone. I'm in a film or what? It's a madhouse, isn't it? It's 2019. There's no jobs. It's packed with muck. I was robbed of, man. My future snatched. A smash and grab job. I don't care now, though. Bloody hell. I'm knackered. Oh, shut off!
You bloody little nutter!
No, Mr. Crab, let me go in.
Joey? Come on, love.
What
are you doing?
Nothing.
Oh, Joey, what are you doing? Why are you starving yourself? This isn't right. Everybody's worried sick, you know. You can't just do this.
Why not?
Look, we all feel like this sometimes, but life must go on.
Why?
Don't be stupid. What about me? I have no job now either. I'm not sitting around behaving like a bloody big kid though. Anyone can do that, you know.
Look, if I wanted Jeremy Kyle, I would have wrote to the bastard. Now go on.
I'd rather get in bed.
I said go on.
No, I'm staying with you. Anything you can do, I can do better.
Ooh.
Are we protesting?
Don't know, love. Why are you here anyway?
I don't know. I suppose I don't know what else to do. Every day's the same now. You was my only hobby, really. Now you're out of it. Seems mad to carry on. All my ambitions, gone. I failed in a honey quiz last week. You got driving force. Got top marks all around. Where can I drive it, Joe? I lost my lovely little job. My office job. I bloody loved working in there, you know. Well, you do know. I told you about it every night. I felt too sweet and neat in there, making odd out of things, tackling an awkward situation here and there. To have a destination. First the bus stop, then the office, then the work on the desk. Learning life's little steps. Now I'm saggy from tip to toe. Every day is like swimming in ink. Can't buy me favourite shampoo. I heard my mum cry again last night. My room's cold. Everybody's poor and sickly white. Oh, Joe.
Come on, lovely. Never mind. Never mind.
I want to understand. Are we protesting?
No, we're just seeing what takes place in our heads.
But we might die.
We might not. We might have some secret revealed to us.
Your mum's on the phone! She's worried! When are you going home?
yeah?
I've never been so happy as the day we met, you know.
It was good though, wasn't it? I remember when you pulled down your shirt to show me your tan.
Oh yeah, I did, didn't I?
You were very flirt back then, wasn't you?
No, I wasn't. That's the first time I'd done Alto Brave.
But you had done it before though.
Only once. Gary Stones on his couch while his mum was ill upstairs. I didn't like it much.
I could imagine.
What do you mean?
It was like bad beef, that blow.
Is he heck?
We're going to have a pig and scene with him then.
Ooh. What about you then? You've had more than a few sexual what's-its-names before me. Sexual adventures, shall we say. What about her then? Jackie Snook. She's no starlet, is she? More like a fartlet. Looks like God gave her an extra armpit to use as a mouth.
Shut it.
Seriously though, tell me about your first sex. You never have.
Why?
I told you. Now we're in this together, we should bring everything out.
Well, that's why I'm doing this, to get everything out.
Go on then.
Right, okay then. Have I not told you this before?
No.
Okay. Me and Steve Carlisle went to Nevada in Bolton. Thursday night, roller skating. The brothel on wheels, it was called. I was about 14 back then. Anyway, we were speaking French to these two bears that we had met. And I said to this bear next to me, "You look very beautiful." She said, "You're not French, you." I said, "I am, I am." Anyway, I kept it up for 15 minutes, admitted it wasn't true, then took her off to the park and fucked her up a bulldozer wheel.
What was that like?
Very muddy.
Oh.
Are you jealous now?
Am I heck? Joe.
Yeah?
This what we're doing, has it got anything to do with Phil Bott? Phil the commie? Because he talks so fast, I never understand a word he says. Tell me no.
No. I went to a few meetings with Phil. We still couldn't decide who to attack. There's not just one person to blame. There's no good or bad. Everything's deeper. When I put myself in to dig for it, I get no answers. Every time I plunge myself into my mind, I'd return empty handed. I'm so unhappy. So fucked off. And every bastard that I meet is just the same.
Joe. I'm hungry.
Go!
No!
Get out!
No, Joe, no!
But don't start then.
For?
Jen found out something.
What?
Well, if I knew, I wouldn't be picking myself up for it, would I?
I don't understand you.
Look, something's missing. Life can't just be this, what everybody's doing.
That way madness lies.
Eh?
That's all my mum ever says. Anytime there's any of that clever talk on the telly. She says it to us. She says to just live your life and get on with it. That's all there is to it.
Oh.
What does that mean?
No. You can't be joking. You're not even messing. You're just like the rest of them. Scared to sniff in the wind and for it to blow up your brain and then fear. And then you'll be wasting your whole lives like work, 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 small wages, small wages, small wages, work, work, getting by with a smile, getting by without a smile. And then death with a big D and no smell left without it. And if you're lucky, you get a see-through memory slowly dissolving like sterilant.
Don't insult my mum, you.
Oh, for fuck's sake, is that all you can say?
Bloody hell.
Eh?
I didn't mean nothing, I'm sorry, okay? I mean, bloody hell, I didn't mean nothing. You've never shown me this face before. I mean, come on, I have no idea.
Well, you should get an idea now and then. You should try it.
Come on now. When did you start thinking like this?
When did I start? When did I stop more like it? I mean, what the fuck, Claire? That's the one. The boy that's hurting my heart. And you don't get to see it, because they rush it from the cradle to the grave. And then there's a standstill. No jobs, no hope. And you've got to ask yourself. You've got to ask yourself the question. You've got to. And it does you some fucking good, you know.
Doesn't look like it's done you much good lying there half dead.
Come on, love. What else the fuck do we have doing? Hey! I feel like England's forcing the brain up my head. I'm sick of it. Sick of it all. People reading the newspapers. Love Island. Boris Johnson melting with shame. Prince Andrew's a paedophile. Being fooled again and again. What the fuck is it? Been laying here for 2 weeks now. On and on through the strain. I wear pain like a hat. Everyone's insane. The world really is a book of devils sick. Every little moment's stupid. I'm sick of people, stupid people, frying the air with their mucky words, their mucky thoughts, their mucky deeds. Where has man gone? Why is he so wrong? Why am I hurt, although I am bruised and gnawed raw? If you could see it, my heart's like an elbow. I've been done by them. The crushing sky of ignorance, vibe ignorance. What did I do? What was the crime? Who do I blame? God for giving me a spark of vision. Not enough of one. Not enough of the other. Just enough of discontent. Enough to have me right on the edge. Not able to get anyone out of here with me. Not able to get in with the rest. Oh God, I'm so far gone, it's too late. I'm half dead. I'm half not sad or glad. I'm not sad or glad. What a fucking bastard and bitch and cunt state to be in. I'm black and sad. Bitterness has swelled like a mighty black rose inside me. Its petals are creaking against my chest. I want it out! 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 Devil God! Devil God! Devil God! Save me something, anything. There's got to be something that will come and help us. If only we can make this right state. If I can't get out myself into the right state, this is it. This is why I'm on the diet. Oh, I'm full of dark frost. Who's done this to me and why? Why? Is it worth that extra bit of bitterness to suffer? Is it? I blame you business and you religion. Its favourite friend hand in hand. You have murdered the child, the man. Murderous cunts. I'd like to cut open your bellies and see the brown paw.
I feel so faint and weak now. I can hardly see my Joey.
Don't worry, love. There'll be a sign and a message soon.
Hey?
You never know when it can come on to you. Fuck me. I wish I had sweat or something. I feel like paper.
I'm all weak and dried out too. My skin cracking.
No.
Around the corners of my mouth, skin cracking.
No.
It feels like this. I love you so much, Joey.
Hey.
I love you, my man. Perhaps if I'd cried, you could. Drink my tears.
Be quiet, Mum.
It feels right funny now. I can feel things real fine in my body. Like the silence within silence within silence. Is it that time?
Stop it. You're talking like you've never spoken in your life.
Where's it coming from?
You. You're more advanced than me now.
Hey?
Just shout out things. That's all I'll test you. Just say what comes to your head.
How can I? I can hardly speak. I'm so knackered out. I feel like I'm only holding on by threads. 2 or 3 fine wet threads. The rest have all dried out and broken.
and love.
I still love you. Don't worry. That's still there. I keep seeing faces. Like my mum's, my dad's. I still want to cry when I see my dad's dismantled face. He lost his last job, you know. Just imagine, one day, it'll be the last job. And everyone will come out to watch the man lose it. Watch as the last hour ticks down. Last two to blow. Whoa, whoa. Being corny now, isn't it, Joe? Oh my. Oh my. It's white in here. Oh my eyes. So misty.
Smart, innit? Smart ass, innit? Turn the back to front on the bed. Look at me. I am pain. I am now tip to toe. Look at me. I am the solution. There is no solution. How's that, right? The smartest ass, as simple as answer going. The last answer to the first question. There is no solution.
Silence Night.
A warning that you are not alone, and we all have a guardian spirit watching over us. Alexei is a small watch companion for planes who discovered he had the power to time travel. The audience surrogate, go find the name of Alexei, meaning righteousness, and justify Alexei as a character who expresses the questions and confusion of you, the audience, and whom you can identify with. During this performance, it's possible you'll forget about everything around you. Just switch off and focus on the story. You will experience an escapism like no other. You will make contact with your inner self. That said, ladies and gentlemen, it's live, it's loud, it's radio, it's gripping in front of a live studio audience. You and its very best, Alexei and Blaze and Final Adventures, are you ready? Are you ready?
Telling us what to do. And you should have seen it, Alexa. Yeah. We must get to that wedding. Yeah, I've got a funny story to share with you, Alexa. Can you hear me? Alexa? Battery's gone. Well, I had a friend, he had a girlfriend. Well, she was a friend, a girl, but she was a girlfriend. Anyway, he wanted her to marry him, so he took her to the London Eye. It had to be special. He wanted it to be special. VIP, champagne capsule, champagne. You should have been there, Alexa. We'll come back to that. Strawberries and whipped cream. It was nice. You should enjoy it. He waited till he got to the top and they asked her to marry him, but she said no. But they were living together and they had a baby together. And she was going round again on her own. It only takes 30 minutes to go round, but she was on there for an hour and a half. She needed some space and time to think. And he said she could have travelled to space in that time. And when he got to the top, he said, "Will you marry me?" She said no. But he got down on one knee, and when she said no, it was total silence. And descending back down to the bottom for 15 minutes. But when they got to the bottom, security were waving them to go back on because there were someone with a suspected heart attack in the capsule behind. So he thought, second time round, second time lucky, do we ask her again? But he didn't, because he knew it's not what she wanted. And that's what's real, Alexa. The present, what you can see, is visual. He wouldn't change a thing because he knew it's not what she wanted, but he had everything he wanted. You see, Alexa, such a devastating story, but if you really look at it and think what you already have, what you've got, that's all that matters. Anyway, the man with a suspected heart attack, it turns out he just had trapped women. He'd been over near him for half an hour. He was on a vegetarian diet. And not forgetting the other fella, because while he was stood waving at her and blowing kisses while she was going round again, the other bloke thought he were doing it to him. And he said, "He were mouthing, when I get down, I'm going to give you a kiss." And he did. When he got down, he gave him a kiss. You see, Alexa, what's the happy ending after all? That's the point of this story. So what now, what next? What happens? What can we do, Alexa? Listen, that's the sound of the universe. It's trying to tell us something. Do the hairs on the back of your neck stand up? Do you feel a cold breeze as if someone from something has just walked past? A cold breeze. And that's when time is moving, but in which direction, we just don't know. This is not the end of the world, this is just the beginning. We must move forwards but backwards. Alexa, what's the temperature? A sudden drop in temperature. That's the cause convention, semiotics, gratifications. The point is in this direction. Or is it this direction? It's one direction. Oh, not the group, not the group. Yes, we start from one end of the earth, certain time and place, thus ending up at the other side of the earth. So what happens in between? Does time stand still? Does time keep moving? What does right now mean? What is right now? Here I am, Alexa, talking to myself, because I'm the one that programmed you after all. At the end of the world where there's just nothing. We can only dream of being in a world where there's no daylight saving. Can you imagine? No Greenwich Mean Time, of course. That's what's controlling all of us, isn't it? Time! Alexa, can you smell it? Take a good deep breath and breathe it all in. That's the atmosphere for you. Complete dampness, nothing can stop us. History's thrown everything it can. It will handle the future. It's like we're caught in a trap and we can't walk out. Because we love the Giddle too much, baby. It's the fundamental laws of the universe. It's only a matter of time. This is by no means the end of the world. This is just the beginning, Alexa. Alexa, hello. The beginning of a new earth, one we care for, one that needs us, one that's crying out for us to change. The earth has spoken to us, Alexa. The universe has brought us here, sending messages back home. With wind. With rain. Let's do this, Alexa. Let's act right now. There's still time to save our planet, our home. This is our place, our future, our decision. This is our time. Are you ready, Alexa? Alexa? Hello? Let's go. Let's do this. Let's kick some ass. Let's fight back for our planet. Let's see what we can do. Let's fight this. Here we go. Bollocks. Let's fight this. Yeah. We're coming to save your planet. We're going to fight this together, Alexa. I'm running. I'm ready. We can do it. Let's go. Come on.
Good evening. This is the news. And tonight we have a public service announcement brought to you by Boys Beware Watch Committee. And now, moving on to tonight's headline. In every large organisation, every big firm, every civil service department, the armed forces and so on, there must be hundreds, even thousands. If all homosexuals were to leave their jobs simultaneously, the economy of the country would be thrown into something like chaos. But by confining ourselves to men, we are only dealing with half of the problem. The word homosexuality is formed from the Greek word homos, which means the same, and it means a person having sexual relations with a person of the same sex. In Britain alone, there are at least 10,000 men and 10,000 women who are homosexual. Now, for some reason, the law takes an entirely different attitude towards the two sexes in this matter. Between women homosexuality, it is completely legal. But for men, it is a crime, rendering the offender liable for several years of imprisonment. There are only half a dozen countries in the world where it is a crime, and for some reason, Britain is one of those. So, what is it like to be a male homosexual in Britain today, whose only choice is between a lifetime of complete sexual abstinence or being a criminal? In 1945, living in post-war Britain, homosexuality was an increasing source of anxiety. This was a period where many people wanted to go back to normal after the upheavals of the Second World War. Currently, in 1965, we are still living with this depressive anxiety. During 1945, the beginning of a new war was born in the form of its own disease that continues to spread amongst our normality. In a world that you don't know anymore, do you really feel safe? In a battle to eliminate this problem, I have found ambassadors leading their own voluntary neighbourhood watch that can help you with the protection of homosexuality or spreading or infecting the loved ones around you. They're going to go through some of the basics in what to look for in a homosexual predator. Over to the neighbourhood watch correspondent, who is going to cover a few signs of the homosexual behaviour. Now, what would you say to a heterosexual man or woman looking to avoid contact with the homosexuals?
Well, I'd like to begin by saying, hi, I'm Navin, leader of the neighbourhood watch, looking to make the community safe for all. To begin with, I would focus on their posture. The way that they hold themselves and move may be an indicator of the homosexual virus. To begin with, the way that they'd walk. A gay man has been known to walk like this, crossing their legs over the other. And the wrist. You have to beware of the wrist. If the wrist becomes limp or droopy like so, combined with the walking, why, you've got a homosexual on your hands. Gay men have also been known to stand like this, drink tea like this. Whoops. And look at you like this.
Navin, are you there, Navin? I'm sorry about this, we seem to be having
some... Homosexuals also have their own form of language. They've been known to cue such phrases as, I really like your handbag. Are you a friend of Dorothy? And can I speak to you about something personal? If you hear one or more of these phrases, you may have a homosexual on your hands, and they must be dealt with swift and effective procedure. They may harm anyone and have been known to target children, so do be careful.
So, what would you tell your child to prevent them from homosexuality in their life, Navin? Dave, come here. Does that look like my fucking angle, Dave? Pan left, pan right, but don't fucking zoom in on my face, Dave. Are you having a laugh, Dave? I've warned you about this, Dave. Dot, I really love the handbag. Where did you get that from? Is that new? I'm so sorry about that. We had another technical difficulty. Dave, cue the music. Homosexualism exists amongst men as much as it does in women. Female homosexuals are often known as lesbians. Again, from the Greek island of Lesbos, where in ancient times the great poet Sappho lived there with a number of other homosexual women. It's always, this is a much easier subject to deal with, whereas male homosexuality is frowned upon in this country, female homosexuality is perfectly legal. Now we're going to go back to Nora, Navin's wife, who is going to tell you how to keep the homosexual predators away from your children.
Well, as a mother, I would ask my child about it. And so, my dear child, what do you think a normal family looks like? Do we look normal enough to you? If you had to pick between one of those two toys, young dear, which one would you choose?
Hey, you know something?
No, what?
I had a wet dream last night. The sperm comes out of your penis.
What? Sperm?
Yeah, sort of a sticky stuff. Guy's part of a baby. Didn't your brother ever tell you about that?
This boy's a homosexual. He's ill. An ill boy.
Innocent looking, but deadly. Your classmates seem to treat you a little coldly. Perhaps it was because you were
a homosexual!
He really wanted to learn to swim. But ill had a handicap. That handicap was ill.
Was a woofter. This is what they call the cruising. He's going to him. He wants to touch. Tips.
No.
My sister was very small. The people next door had a large
perverted dog.
He was a rough, noisy dog, too. He kept fenced in the yard all the time. Sis came up quite close to the fence. When the dog came running toward her, she became perverted.
Oh.
Now, wait a minute. You want to know what...
A homosexual.
Is that what you call...
The communist?
Yes!
Oh, yes, that's right. You see... It could knock you down hard. Or throw you against a tree or a wall. It can smash in buildings, knock signboards over, and break windows all over town.
Hey, Coach, didn't you say it was glands that made guys different?
Yeah, that's right. The testes start making a chemical substance called a hormone. It's this hormone that causes the...
homosexuals.
What can you do about it?
You should see a doctor. He'll tell you what to do. It can be cleared up pretty well these days. Well, that's it for today, fellas. Let's get out to practice, huh?
I'm sure we can agree. A very enlightening film.
So, for the viewers back at home watching, how did this make you feel? How do you think we can change these problems? And most of all, what does a normal family look like to you?
Very, very much.
No, I'm so impressed with all the positive action. Although it only tackles a fraction of the issues we face, we're still dealing with sex, ability, gender and race, not to mention the disgrace surrounding marriage, religion and age. I am so proud to embrace the idea of equality and diversity. When discrimination becomes positive, when we favour people who suffer discrimination, or when we discriminate against others to make up for the discrimination that's already happened, we are breaking the pattern. Get with it, it's called positive action.
I'm a peer mentor now, you know, where you mentor your peers. I've just finished the course, it was wow. So rather than having fears of speaking out, you can give me a shout. I'm your peer, you know me anyways. I'm just someone who will listen. I've got the network of support. We're all on a mission.
We've even got an online system. It's confidential between our team. And all you see on the screen is red, amber, and green. So when we walk or sit and talk, when you share with me your inner thoughts, I will report on our system. I won't share a conversation with them. I'll just give it a title and a colour. For example, if you're feeling rather under, so much that it makes you wonder, that if I don't help you, you might hurt yourself or someone else. So for yours and my own safety, I will give you the colour red. If I think my peers here, the situation is clear. I no longer have the skills or knowledge to adhere to their needs. I'm not qualified indeed. So I will inform someone I trust, someone who must pass the information on to the relevant people. If I'm worried, but not so much, if I'm dealing with it as such, but I'm sure they're fully in touch, I'll click amber. So I don't feel the need to pass it on. It's a bit more than I can deal with myself. You know what I mean, take on? When it's green, this is where it will mostly be. It's conversations they're having with me, where I actually manage to help, where my role as a mentor to my peers is being fulfilled.
Oh, hey.
Hey.
How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling okay.
Are you okay?
Yeah. I haven't had the best morning, nor the best week. Haven't been in the gym. Feeling rather weak.
Oh, no way. Come and sit down. You don't sound okay. So, what happened this morning?
My alarm went off, and I turned it off. I just didn't get up. Every time I wake up, I just want to go back to sleep.
And have you been feeling like this all week?
All I want to do is sleep. Zone out. Escape.
What is it you want to escape from?
That story's a long one.
Hey! Oh, hey! How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling high. What about you?
I'm fine. You're feeling high? What do you mean?
I'm feeling high as in I'm happy. Elated and free.
Oh, that's great. You're in the green, mate. Okay, log in. Conversation log one. Begin. Name, Nina. Subject, depression. Color, Amber. Conversation log two. Name, Rachel, subject, mood swings, colour, green.
All done. I'm glad I didn't see a person that was red. I don't know what I would have said.
If it bleeds through her sleeve, but still no one's seen, and then she came to me and told me, I'm cutting myself, but please don't tell. I'll only lie and say that I fell. I'm fine. I never cut too deep. I know which way to cut the line. I promise I'm fine. I only needed someone to tell, and I trusted you.
Of course, if something like that were to happen, it would also so happen that I would have had to let her know from the start that not full confidentiality is part of my mentoring role. If the situation is out of my control, I would have to let other people know. Thank God, no one was in the red though.
Shh.
snoozed again. I'm going to be late. I don't want to get up at all. I've hit a wall. How long is my fall? I don't want to go to this job interview at all. But I want to. I need a life. I know it's right. Okay, Siggy is lit. I'm making a coffee. Now, nothing will stop me. Okay, so I think today, I might get a shower. Splash me face. Brush my teeth. Got me hair looking neat. Makeup on, I'm feeling on fleek. I am ready to speak. What will I say? Will I say hello, hi, or hey? My name's Nina, and I'm here for the interview. You know what? That'll do.
Oh, hello.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you today?
I'm good, and you?
I'm great. Have you got the form?
Yeah, of course, here it is.
Oh, that's great. So, tell me about yourself, mate. Are you ready to pull the weight?
I've got the skills and experience you require, and I'm always keen to acquire more.
Oh, that's just the attitude we adore. Thank you for your time. Oh, just before you go, I was wondering if you might know the race of that girl over there. Because we want to hire diverse people, you see, and I can't quite tell if she is white. You know, she might qualify as diverse.
There's definitely something in there. Not that I care. But if I had to guess, I'd say I was caught between Martian or Plutonian.
I can't take it anymore. And I'm 100% sure you're judging our mental health by a colour.
Oh, you didn't think? I wonder why you're asking all these questions. I've seen that obscene system on your screen with that bullshit red, amber and green. Oh, I'm red today, am I? But you didn't think to ask if I was red down there, though. That has a huge effect on a woman's mood, you know. But now, I've got this red flag. Like, I'm some unstable person. Like I have a mental issue? Oh, you think I need help, do you? I know that all these rules and regulations are meant to save implementation of diversity and equality, but they just induce feelings of adversity within me. I want to be free. I want to be seen for me. Scares me to know that I'm just a commodity, a file filled with data, ones and zeros, defining who I am, making me neglect my true feelings. If it's not politically correct, my lips need sealing. Whatever happens, it's a freedom of speech. I think my human rights are being breached.
All these procedures and labels march us to our stables, straight to the grave from our cradles. As we conform to the prescribed norm, so misinformed and over-educated, way too educated, always ensuring we fit into the boxes.
Little boxes on the hillside, little boxes made of ticky-tacky, little boxes on the hillside, little boxes all the same. There's a pink one and a green one and a blue one and a yellow one, and they're all made out sort of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same.
When's the audience coming?
America's most notorious serial killers, Ted Bundy.
Frances Massey lived across the hall from Bundy and knew him as Chris. She said she was one of his few friends.
What kind of person was he?
A quiet type person. Aloof and friendly.
You talk to him?
Yes, sometimes.
Did you ever feel any fears being around him?
No. Not fear.
When you talk to him, what would you talk about?
Everyday stuff. How he's doing today and things like that. It's kind of hard to generalize a character in a living situation like that.
Can you go out to dinner with him one time?
And we went out to dinner once. That's kind of...
Knowing what you know now, does that frighten you? To put that much trust in a person?
Well, under the circumstances that we went out to dinner, it was pretty casual. And we trusted each other enough to go out to dinner. Just as friends do.
The murder trial of Theodore Bundy goes into its fourth week in Miami today after a long weekend. Friday's session was delayed because the defendant was suffering from a virus. He's accused in the brutal slayings of two Florida State University sorority sisters in January 1978. His trial has attracted a steady and unusual stream of spectators. Robin Lloyd of station WTVJ reports.
Each day, the courtroom is filled with spectators drawn by a fascination with Theodore Bundy himself or by the gruesome details of the crimes. Bloodstained pillows, pictures of the murdered co-eds, evidence that the women were sexually abused. What is unusual to see is that many of the onlookers are women, young women, contemporaries of the five Florida State sorority sisters who were assaulted in their beds a year and a half ago.
Every time he turns around, I kind of get that feeling, oh no, you know, gonna get me next.
But yet you're fascinated by him.
Very. Every night when I go to bed, I just, you know, I get very scared and I shut my door and lock him.
I'm not afraid of him. He just doesn't look like the type to kill somebody. You try to imagine yourself in his place and see how he's feeling, looking at the pillows with blood stains and everything, if he really did it or not.
Just imagine having the chance to be with someone as handsome as him.
He just doesn't seem the type he's...
I just think who his next victim would be. Like, he holds a certain fascination.
Yeah, I'd say he's attractive. Very attractive.
Just imagine having the chance to be with someone as handsome as him.
I just think, who was next victim?
Yeah, like, I'd say he's attractive.
Would it be me?
Very attractive.
Hi there, I'm Ted. Hi, nice to meet you. Hi there. Hi, I'm Ted. Lovely to meet you. Hi there, I'm Ted. Yeah, how you doing? Excuse me, do you mind helping me with this? Just come with me? That's all right? Cheers. Come on, thank you.
June 11th, 1974. I was walking down a dimly lit alleyway to my house. A man approached me. He was very charming. And he was having trouble with his bags, as he had his arm in a sling. I helped him carry his briefcase. He knocked me unconscious and shoved me in his car. I woke up to him on top of me. I tried to struggle and get him off me. He started to rape me and knock me unconscious again. He strangled me. He then decapitated me.
February 9th, 1978. It was raining. I had started to walk across the schoolyard after retrieving my purse that I had left in another class, when a man approached me and grabbed me by the arm and dragged me down to the street towards a white van. Over the next few days, the news reports started with pleas of finding me from my parents, family and friends. April 7th. My body was found in a shed in the woods. I was beaten and strangled, then he raped me.
November 8th, 1974. It was a Friday. I didn't really have plans that night, so I decided I would get in my car and head out for the mall. I drove to the parking lot, parked under the light, and walked into the mall. Started looking in a bookstore window, and as I was looking in the window, a man approached me. He said he was a police officer. He said, "We found someone trying to break into your car." He was polite. He asked me if I wanted to come to the car with him and see if anything was missing. So we got out to my car, and I could see in the car that nothing was missing, but he kept leaning forward, like he wanted me to look further into the car. But I wouldn't. I just said, "Nothing's missing." And that's when he said, "Well, they're holding this guy down at the police station. Do you have time to come down there and fill out the complaint against them?" And then I said, "Do you have some kind of identification? Because I was just starting to feel a little uneasy." I thought I could smell alcohol, and that's when he just promptly pulled out his wallet and showed me a badge. So I said, "Okay." He drove a Volkswagen, which I thought, well, that's kind of odd, but maybe he's under something. So I got in. He headed down a side street, and then he suddenly pulled over with the side of the curb by an elementary school. And that's when I just started freaking out. What are you doing? I'm going to grab my arm. He got one hand cuffed, and then he didn't get the other one on, so it was just dangling. I'd never been so frightened in my entire life. And I know this is cliche, but my whole life went before my eyes. I thought, my God, my parents are never gonna know what happened to me. The next thing I know, he pulled out a gun. He said, I'll blow your head off. I just thought, go ahead. Just go ahead, do it. Just kill me now. But I found the door, jumped out the car, and then he came out after me and we struggled outside. He had a crowbar and he was trying to hit me over the head. I had my hand on top, I could feel it. I just fought with all my life, thrashing him and fighting. My fingernails were all broken. I remember his beady, blank, lifeless eyes. At that time, a car started coming the other direction, and that's when I broke loose and ran to the car. I flew open the doors and jumped in on them and said, take me to the police station. I was just hysterical.
I was very lucky. I got news later that day that he was so angry that I'd gotten away. He just drove somewhere else and killed someone else.
State of Florida versus Theodore Robert Bundy.
Verdict. We, the jury of the County Court in the State of Florida, 24th of July 1979, find the defendant Theodore Robert Bundy on the account of the indictment, murder in the first degree on one Margaret Bowman, guilty as charged. In the indictment, murder in the first degree on one Lisa Levi, guilty as charged.
The court finds that both of these killings were indeed heinous, atrocious and cruel, and that they were extremely wicked, shockingly evil, vile, and the product of a design to inflict a high degree of pain and utter indifference to human life. This court, independent of, but in agreement with, the advisory sentence rendered by the jury, has hereby imposed a death penalty upon the defendant, Theodore Robert Bundy. Take care of yourself, young man. And I say that to you sincerely. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
It's a tragedy for this court to see such a total waste, I think, of humanity that I have experienced in this court. You're a bright young man. You would have made a good lawyer. I would love to have seen you practice in front of me, but you went another way, partner. Take care of yourself. I don't have any animosity for you. I want you to know that. Court will be in recess until Saturday morning, 10 o'clock.
I'm
I'm not asking for mercy. For I find it somewhat absurd to ask for mercy for something I did not do. So I will be tortured for and will suffer for and receive the pain for that act. But I will not share the burden.
waking up for us meant opening our eyes and trying to fight through the fog that had been created in our minds. Lysergic acid diethylamide is used in the modern day to create euphoria. For us, it was used to bring pain and torture. Before we can begin to make sense of what's happening to us, our body goes into a rigid, outstretched position. All of our muscles tightened, our head falls back and our chin up in the air. We do not know how long this lasts, but our body goes up again. We open our eyes and we try to look around, but we're unable to move. Why can't we move? Everything is blurry. But we can see and feel that men are there. An excruciating pain because of all of our nerve endings. And through the sound of our recent heartbeat, we can hear one of the men call out.
Three more rounds! You lose control. To the extent that you let the agent choose, you don't have control.
What would you do? Someone you loved turned around and said they were going to kill themselves. Laugh it off and say, no, you're not.
Be concerned for about an hour as you attempt to help them, but then go along with your normal life, like nothing happened.
Recommend they go see a doctor or seek some professional help.
Or maybe, just tell someone else and hope that they do something about it.
In the UK and Republic of Ireland, there were 6,589 suicides in 2018. In the UK, there were 6,507 suicides alone.
Death by suicide rose by 10.9% in the UK in 2018.
Just because you can't see a mental illness like you can see a broken bone, it doesn't mean it's not there.
People tell you to just shrug it off. You'll get through it. It's just a rough patch. But what if I don't?
The doctor gave me some medicine. Told me to take two a day. One in the morning and one at night, like clockwork. If it doesn't work, to go back. I've been back 3 times. It's not getting any better. First time I self-harmed. I was struggling with my mental health for a while. I felt low, anxious, overwhelmed on a daily basis. I needed an escape. I needed something to take away from this emotional dread inside. Physical pain felt easier to cope with than the emotional one. It gave me control when it felt like I had none. However, it became my go-to way of coping and, well, it felt impossible to stop. After today,
I shall not speak again.
I'm gonna kill myself, Mama.
Very funny.
Very funny.
I am. No, you're not. Don't even say such a thing!
I am. I feel like the future's hopeless, and there's nothing to stop it.
I'm sad.
I'm bored and dissatisfied with everything.
I'm a complete failure as a person. I would like to kill myself.
I used to be able to cry, but now I'm beyond tears.
I've lost interest in other people.
Save me from myself!
I can't make decisions.
I can't eat.
I can't sleep.
I can't think.
I can't overcome my loneliness, my fear, my disgust.
It comes in waves. I close my eyes, hold my breath and let it bury me.
I, in fact, cannot love. My lover's dying. My family's dying. I'm killing them all.
I'm charging towards my death.
I'm terrified of my medication!
I can't be alone! I
can't be with others.
When the darkness comes,
I shall kill myself.
To the sound of my lover's breathing.
I don't want to die.
What doesn't kill you makes you wish you were dead.
I've become so depressed at the fact of my mortality that I've decided to kill myself. Who will fix me now?
Time for your medicine!
I went to the doctor. A room of expressionless faces, so devoid of meaning there must be evil intent. Doctor this, and doctor that, and Dr. Watson, who was just passing and thought they'd pop in to take the piss as well. They stumble over my words, and have nothing to say about my illness. Which, anyway, only amounts to knowing nothing because I'm going to die. Doctor that, this, write it down. And Doctor that attempts a sympathetic murmur. Watching me, judging me, smelling the crippling failure oozing from my skin, my depression clawing into me, all-consuming panic drenching me as I look at the world and wonder why everyone's smiling and looking at me with sacred knowledge of my aching shame.
Shame, shame, shame.
Drown in your fucking shame!
You're not going to kill yourself. You're not even upset. People don't really kill themselves unless you're taught or enraged. And you're as normal as you come.
Have you made any plans?
Take some pills, slash my wrists, and then kill myself.
All these things at once couldn't possibly be misconstrued as a cry for help. It wouldn't work.
Of course it would.
It wouldn't work. You'd start to feel sleepy from the overdose. You wouldn't have the energy to cut your wrists.
I'd be standing on a chair with a rope around my neck.
If you're alone, do you think you might harm yourself?
I'm scared I might.
Take these. Should start to feel better in 4 to 6 weeks. If not, come back and see me again. Have a lovely day.
No amount of medication can make life worth living. I used to look in the mirror sometimes, try and see the madness seeping from my eyes. I never did. I'd look back, smiling, gently, with such a wise gleam. Chemical imbalance. Okay, let's do the drugs. Let's lower the higher functions of my brain, and maybe then I'll be a little bit more fucking capable of living.
Mama, I'm just not having a very good time. I don't have any reason to think it'll get anything but worse. I'm tired, I'm hurt, I'm sad, I'm feeling used. I'm tired of what? It all. What does that mean? I can't say it. Well, you'll have to say it better, because that doesn't make sense. Read the paper, watch the TV, get up every day, do the same thing, day in, day out, whilst acting like everything is fine, with a big smile on my face. It's tiring. You're acting like some spoiled little brat. You're mad and everyone's boring and you don't have anything to do and you don't like me or anyone, you don't like going out, you don't like staying, you're miserable.
And it's your own sweet fault! Maybe it's time I did something about it!
Oh dear, what's happened to your arm?
I cut it.
That's a very silly, immature, attention-seeking thing to do. Did it give you relief?
No.
Did it relieve the tension?
No.
Did it give you relief? Did it give you relief?
No.
I don't understand why you did that.
Then ask.
Did it give you relief? I thought you might do it. Lots of people do. It relieves the tension.
Have you ever done it?
No.
Far too fucking sane and sensible. I don't know where you read that, but it does not relieve the tension. You want to know why? Ask me why I cut myself.
Would you like to tell me?
Yes.
Then tell me.
Then ask me why.
Why did you cut your arm?
Because it feels fucking great. Because it feels fucking amazing.
Can I look?
You can look, but don't touch.
And you don't think you're real?
No.
I do. It's not your fault, but you have to take responsibility for your actions. Please don't do it again.
It's not your fault. It's all I ever hear. It's not your fault. It's just an illness. It's not your fault. I know it's not my fault, but you've told me that it's not my fault so often that I'm starting to think that it is my fault.
It's not your fault.
I know!
I don't know what I did. But I did it, I know. It was my fault. How can I live without you? I need you.
Should have picked up the phone more, or went round to you more, or just did anything. If I was a better friend, you wouldn't be in this state.
Are you sure it's not just a rough patch? I'm sure things will get better once everything's settled down.
Have you taken your medicine?
Time your medicine! Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die?
Diagnosis? Pathological grief?
Sertraline, 50 milligrams, insomnia worsened, severe anxiety, anorexia, increase in suicidal thoughts, plans and intention discontinued following hospitalization.
Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, no speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die. Zolpiclone, 7.5 milligrams. Slept. Discontinued following rash. And the patient attempted to leave the hospital against medical advice. Restrained by two male nurses, twice her size. The patient was threatening and uncooperative. Paranoid thoughts. Believes the hospital staff are attempting to poison her.
Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die.
Melaril, 50 milligrams. Cooperative.
Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die.
The fuck for me. 70 milligrams. Increase to 140 milligrams. Increase to 210 milligrams. Weight gain, 12 kilograms. Short-term memory loss. No other reaction.
Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, no speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die. Argument with junior doctor, whom she accused of treachery after she shaved her head and cut her arms with a razor blade.
Says here, the patient was discharged into the care of the community on arrival of acutely psychotic, a patient in the emergency clinic was in greater need of a hospital bed.
Citalopram, 20 milligrams. Morning tremors, no other reaction.
Symptoms!
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die.
Lofrapamine and citalopram. Discontinued after the patient got pissed off with the side effects. And with, well, no other improvements. Discontinuation symptoms. Dizziness and confusion. The patient's kept falling over, fainting, and walking out in front of cars. Delusional ideas. Believes the consultant is the Antichrist.
Symptoms.
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die.
Mood.
Looking angry.
Effect.
Very angry.
Thorazine, 100 milligrams. Slept.
Karma.
Refused all further treatment.
Symptoms.
Not eating, not sleeping, not speaking, no sex drive, in despair, wants to die.
Thank you.
feel?
How do I fucking feel?
Disappointed.
Angry.
You led me to believe I was going insane.
When in fact you were just hiding your compulsive lies behind a mask of misery.
I'm the victim.
Not you!
How dare you lay my innocence on your petty manipulative,
cohesive behaviour?
Emotional blackmail?
Dick move.
I finally realised what people mean when true colours really show.
And yours were dark.
Don't get me wrong. This feeling is the only thing I felt for months.
And now it's just the feeling of regret deep in the pit of my stomach. Don't get me wrong, we made some pretty good memories. Memories I thought I'd want to forever cherish.
And now?
I just try so hard to forget them.
Drowning in
end of the day, I find myself struggling to make the best of a bad situation. Until now, I may have lost you, but I won myself back.
Oh! Another man, his neighbors and teachers loved him. They thought he was a great Casey split up, though, after Ralph became concerned with Casey's wellness. He found magazines with naked boys on them, and Casey even openly admitted preferring boys over women. Soon after this, Casey formed a construction company and hired mostly teenage boys to help him run it. Strangely, many teenage boys started disappearing from the town. Investigators immediately went to the house of Casey, who claimed to have no knowledge of the topic. Something about Casey did not sit right with the police. They were shocked to find out about his history with boys and got a warrant to search his house. Inside, they found many disturbing items, including boys' clothing items and child pornography. Other than this, though, the house appeared to be relatively normal. They brought him down to the station once again for questioning, but he again denied having any relations with the disappearances. Lab technicians were luckily able to make a breakthrough in the case when they found DNA from some of the missing boys on the items found in Casey's home. Investigators approached Casey with the new discoveries, and he confessed to killing one boy in self-defense. He claimed that the boy was buried under his garage. Police marked off this area, but also started digging the suspicious crawl space, which gave a horrible odor. After 2 minutes of digging, a corpse was found. In total, 33 corpses were found, some of these even coming from the Des Plaines River.
Thank you.